A very warm welcome from wherever you're watching us in Kenya and beyond. This is WTV Sports Center. Always a pleasure being your host. My name is Elijah Mwangi. 22nd August 2015, it is a weekend full of action in China and also in Japan. In Japan, we have our volleyball team there, that is Malkia Strikers in Tokyo, and their opening game is against Cuba. We wish them the very best. And in China, the athletics team is there for the Beijing World Championship. Will they come back with more medals this time round? That remains to be seen. But we do hope that indeed they'll have more gold medals. And also still in this show, later on, I'll be joined by one John Kianda, our guest analyst today, to discuss more concerning the English Premier League. The big match being on Monday, that is Arsenal versus Liverpool. But even before we go to the English Premier League, let's see some of the top stories that are making the headlines. We start with Matters Rugby. We've been having quite a number of tournaments, that is the National Sevens Series, from Masaku Sevens to this weekend we have the Driftwood Sevens in Mombasa, and next weekend we have the Prinsloo Tournament in Nakuru. Well, many people focus on such tournaments. What people don't know is that we have other emerging tournaments. Such tournament is Chebarbar Sevens. What is it about Chebarbar Sevens? Let's find out. You've probably seen this animated video.
In the starting, in the coming, in the Msuri, in the going, in the Chebarbar.
No doubt, Wasingishu is the city of champions, but that city of champions is also diversifying to ensure a certain population discovers and gets to showcase their talents in rugby. The Chebarbar Sevens will be held on 3rd and 4th October this year. The tournament, which is growing by the year, is expected to attract at least 18 teams. Samuel Lemayan is the chairman of the organizing committee for Chebarbar Sevens. We speak to him concerning the expectations of Chebarbar Sevens this year, as well as his general assessment of the Kenyan rugby.
I think Kenya can do much better when it comes to rugby, especially with the amount of money that is being pumped into rugby right now and the craze that it has in Kenya right now. So many people, so many counties, so many institutions are willing to partner up with rugby institutions or other rugby clubs to, you know, push the rugby sensation further, or rather push that interest further. So many institutions are now adopting rugby right now, and we have so much money that can be put aside for training alone. But currently our team, Kenyan team, is not performing so well, maybe because of the kind of politics that is happening in KRU currently. But I feel that with the coming year and the new season, the new season that we are having this year, I think that Sevens will actually do a better job than what we've seen previously.
We can only wish them the very best. Now let's go to your case. You are the chief organizer or the chairman of Chebarbar Sevens. What is Chebarbar Sevens?
Chebarbar Sevens is a rugby tournament that we hold in Wasingishu County, specifically Eldoret. We started it 2 years ago, but last year was our biggest break. We had a huge number of people coming around. We had over 10,000 people gracing the event. It was a one-day event, though this year it's going to be a two-day event.
Now, preparations underway, so far so good. How are you faring in terms of sponsorship? Because for you to have a very good event, you must consider, you know, the money factor. Money is everything when it comes to sports. So far so good. How are you performing in that area?
I would say that money is actually a key role player in organizing rugby events. It's an expensive affair. I'm not allowed to say disclose right now who is aboard and who is not, but so far we have around 4 sponsors who are aboard. We're still looking for other sponsors.
And perhaps maybe I should have even started by asking why Chebarbar, because Chebarbar is a guy that we know with athletics. So why Chebarbar?
Chebarbar is actually associated with the word home. And you know, I would say that in Rift Valley, home is a... is that place that you always want to be. It's a happy place. So Chebarbar came about. You are aware of this guy called Lakong, who was a runner, and he made a joke about Chebarbar. Chebarbar is actually a name of a place in Rift Valley, and we adopted the name because it felt more closer to home. Yes.
And something else, that apart from that event itself, What do you aim to achieve? Because we have people organizing marathons and such events for charity to raise money to nurture talent. So where do you stand?
One is to mentor talent. That is our biggest achievement so far. We've been able to mentor a couple of teams that wanted to join, you know, start their own rugby teams and high schools. We usually do monthly rugby mini tournaments for high schools so that we can come up, help the institutions grow the sport in their high schools and, you know, some few colleges in Uasin Gishu and Rift Valley at large. We've gone as far as Nandi County, and we are also partnering with them hopefully next year to do a collab of the two counties sort of event, but still under the name Chebarbar.
Your word to the upcoming or rising stars when it comes to rugby as a game, what would you tell them?
Upcoming, keep playing rugby. Rugby is it's a career actually right now. It's the money thing right now. Yeah, so if you want to play rugby, it can be your career. You can make money out of it, but all you have to do is to be committed and, you know what, love the game.
Moving on to one of my favorite segments here at WTV Sports Center, that is the player of the week. Last week, we featured Musa Otieno, the much decorated footballer in Kenya. That was in the spirit of celebrating our very own. And this time round, it's no different, but we focus on rugby. And we feature Collins Injera, arguably one of the best rugby players we have in Africa. Let's have a look at Collins Injera, the rugby player.
So ball back into Kenya's hands. What can Biko Adima do to set up Collins Injera? Injera has a little cut now. Injera, this is going to be the moment where Collins Injera scores his 200th try in a Kenyan jersey on the Sevens World Series. And Injera, well, he's such a character, and he's signing the ball. Look at this. Is this not brilliant? Oh, I love
that.
We have
to have the restart, but...
Congratulations. Where did he have that pen? Not sure the cameraman's going to be too happy about that one from now on, but what a way to mark your 200th try.
When the Kenyan superstar Collins Injera celebrated his 200th try on the World 7 Series by taking out a permanent marker from his socks and signing the ball, news went viral, causing a bit of a stir around the globe for as much good as bad. Well, it was a classic celebration with the marker stored in his socks until being needed. There were concerns about the damage to the camera. So, who is this Collins Injera? Injera is a Kenyan rugby player. He's known for his achievements with the Kenya National Rugby Sevens team. He's one of the top career try scorers of all time on the World Rugby Sevens Series.
Just charges his way to the line, Collins Injera.
Now a strong player for the Kenya Sevens squad, Injera started with the team at the 2006 Dubai Sevens and played in the 2009 Rugby World Cup Sevens, where Kenya reached the semi-finals. He became the top try scorer for the 2008-2009 IRB Sevens World Series season with 42 tries. Injera was nominated for the 2009 IRB Sevens Player of the Year award, which was eventually won by Oli Phillips of England. Injera won the Kenya Sportsman of the Year award in 2009, and in 2010, Injera was awarded the Presidential Order of Golden Warriors alongside his brother Humphrey Kayange for their performance in the 2008-2009 IRB Sevens World Series. And we are just about to talk to one of the legends when it comes to Kenyan rugby, that is Collins Injera. Thank you very much, Collins, for making time for us. How has been your experience so far so good in Kenyan rugby? Not Masakus, but Kenyan rugby.
Kenyan rugby. Hey, that's a while back. But I think my whole experience personally has been awesome. I think starting way back in 2005 after clearing high school in the Kenyan rugby scene, it was quite tough. But I think just through hard work, determination, staying disciplined at all times, and just staying focused to your goal, I think my experience, I can say, generally has been amazing.
Maybe you can tell us what has been your highest moment and as well as your lowest moments in terms of the Kenyan rugby.
I've had quite a few high moments and also some few, not I can't say few, quite some low moments. But the high moments were reaching the first semi-final in the World Cup in 2009 and also doing it again, all over again in 2013. Being the top prize scorer in the series 2008-2009 series, beating New Zealand in their backyard. I think there are quite so many high moments that I can count. On the low moment side, we've had quite a few. We had a high season, then coming like to 2013, we had a very good season, finished top five in the world. Yes. I think coming next season, we didn't perform well. We went down. And also this season has been quite a low moment. I think the team flirting on the relegation zone wasn't quite a good thing. But I think at last we managed to pull through, and we are still in the core team series. So I've had quite a few high and low moments in the rugby scene.
Well, that's nice. Now, there are so many people, especially young players, that look, you know, you as the role model. But some are blind about some of the challenges that you guys go through. Maybe you can just take us through some of the challenges.
I can say challenges actually vary with individuals, but generally the challenges that keep work. I think when you work hard, and some of the young players might think that they are working hard, but their moment hasn't come. Your moment will come if you stay focused to your goal, keep working hard. Your moments will definitely come. So I think that's the general challenge I can say, because people think that I've worked too hard, but it hasn't come. So he's giving up and moving on to other things. I think what I can tell them is, I think never give up. Just keep working, because you never know when that moment will come. It might come when you're playing in a club level. It might come while training. You'll never know. But what I can tell them is just keep working hard, and things will fall into place.
Wow, that's quite inspiring. Now, coming to Masaku Sevens now, we've seen you, you know, advising some teams here. So are you playing, and how about Masaku Sevens now?
Actually, Masaku Sevens has always been special to me, because I remember when they launched it the first time, I was the guest player, and when we were still playing at the golf course. And last year I didn't come to Masaku because we were away on national duty. But I think every time I'm around, I have to come to Masaku, because it's such a nice place for developing rugby. You can see all the nice teams coming, bringing in young boys who are trying to play it in the big stadium. At least they get a feel of the big stadium. And also for development wise, it's quite a good place to be. I've met so many young guys here who are really working hard to make it in the team, in the national team.
Okay, and of course some critics have said that, you know, rugby in Kenya is marred by so many things when it comes to leadership. If you are to change something in Kenyan rugby so that you can take it to the highest level, what can you do?
If I were me, I think I would try to put in more resources in the team and into the program, because I think the next level for Kenyan rugby is to put it professionally. Where you wake up, play rugby, go to sleep, wake up the next morning, get your salary, get your everything. But that's just me putting so much resources. I think we need to invest in the sport.
Of course, we cannot end this conversation without talking about that the million signature. What do you have to talk about? I know you've spoken about it before, but maybe you can just, you know, for the purpose of record on WTV, tell us about that experience when you had to sign the camera.
Where do I start? I knew I was going to sign the ball. The camera actually just popped in after I scored the try and signed the ball. And the camera signature was actually for the fans out there. I scored my 200th try and realized it's such a big moment. And just shows how long I've come as a player since I started way back in 2006. And up to now scoring my 200th try. It was such a great milestone. And I thought about the fans who have been really there with the team when we had our highs, when we had our lows. And I signed the camera for them at home.
After you signed, there were a lot of talk, especially on social media. So how did it end?
It was too much speculation and assumption. Nothing happened. I was never approached by anyone to come and pay the camera. I don't know where the story came from. And as you know, blogs will say anything to get traffic.
Of course, so many people look up to you as the role model. And as we wind up this conversation, maybe you have a message for them, to inspire them, to encourage them when it comes to rugby. What can we really tell them?
I think in regards to rugby is stay focused, stay disciplined, stay determined, and things will fall into place. Never give up. When you keep working hard and things are not working out for you personally, you just keep on doing it. I believe in keep doing it. The opportunities will definitely come. And one thing I believe is that it's never about the opportunity of a lifetime. You might get one opportunity and think that, that was it. It's never about that. It's about the lifetime of that opportunity. When you get that opportunity, how long will that opportunity last? Because opportunities are always there. Nobody, we can't say that I had this one opportunity and I blundered. No, the next one will come. And it's how it's a matter of how you will use the timeline of that opportunity.
And Kenya Sevens is currently at position 13 when it comes to this series. So your expectations now from now moving on?
Now I think we are resting. We're on off season, but we're just about to resume. I think next week we might be resuming next week. But moving on, we still have the World Cup the Olympic qualifiers in South Africa. So at the moment, that's the priority. So we need to qualify for the Olympics. Then from there, we can begin our series.
At this point, we take a short break, but don't go far, because after the break, John Kianda, my guest analyst for today, will be joining me to discuss English Premier League as well as the Kenya Premier League, now called SportsPesa Premier League. And we have the Mashemeji Derby, Gor Mahia playing AFC Leopards on Sunday. Stay tuned. Welcome back, and we are glad that you are still watching WTV Sports Center. And as I promised, my guest analyst is here. That is John Kianda, a sports writer and also a presenter. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Thank you so much. Now, we say charity begins at home. So even if we are discussing matters concerning English Premier League, let's look at how our Kenyans are doing, especially in the international front. And we can't talk of international scene without mentioning athletics, because the Kenyan squad to the 15th IAAF World Athletics Championship arrived in Beijing on Wednesday. And this is for a 9-day riveting action that kicks off this Saturday. Now, John, let's start from our athletes in China. You know, in Moscow, we saw them fetch about 12 medals. From where you see it, do we see any change?
Basically, visited them several times in their training camps at Kasarani and the marathon team in Iten.
Yeah.
So far, the team has stayed together for quite some time, which is a different, I think, they've done this time around compared to the previous World Athletics Championship. So basically, people are having doubts if Rudisha is going to make it, because the previous edition, he didn't run, but he still holds the 800 meters world record. So the medals that everyone is sure we're going to get, I have to say the marathon, because you have the likes of Dennis Kimeto, we have Wilson Kipsang, Karen, and the previous world record holder in marathon. 800 meters is a doubt. Jairus Biresh has been doing very well in the Diamond League of late. David Rudisha, this young man from Botswana called Nigel Amos, who is doing very well, giving Rudisha a run for his money. Reason why Rudisha is not performing well is basically because of the injury that he had, and he hasn't recovered very well. And during that time, Nigel Amos cemented his place in the 800 meters different league, the Diamond League and the World Athletics Championship. So I have to say, 3,000 meters steeplechase, the captain himself, that's Ezekiel Kemboi, the likes of Conseslus Kipruto. I think we have a gold medal there.
We have a gold medal. So
10,000 meters, I'm not really sure, because this time round, the different thing that Vivian Cheruiyot is doing, she's not going to run the 5,000 meters. She's focusing on the 10,000 meters. And she has had mixed results in different races that she has been into. So according to me, 800 meters women, Yunisu, that's a gold medal. Then Ezekiel Kemboi, 3,000 meters.
Going to have the
Kemboi
dance?
Yes, it's called the Emily Chipchumba dance.
Yes.
And then we talked about 800 meters Unisum, 3,000 meters steeplechase, Ezekiel Kemboi, marathon. Those are the three races that I'm sure we're going to have a gold medal.
Let's move away from tracks and go to, you know, javelin. We have our YouTube athlete there. I mean, that is Julia Siego. Do you think he will have that monster throw and, emerge victorious?
I spoke to Julius Yego at Kasarani when I was training. He stays around there. He's a policeman.
Yes.
And he's an Arsenal fan, I just had to say.
Oh, okay. We'll get to the Arsenal.
So,
yeah.
He said that when he broke the African record and the championship record, I think it was in Birmingham.
Yes.
He didn't expect. It doesn't just come easily. Mm. The first throw, second throw, were just the ordinary throws. The third one, he didn't expect he's going to do that, but he had to give his best because he was the third one. So he says that he wants to do his best. He doesn't want to break any record. He just wants to improve on his previous performances. That's what he did. You know, that's basically taking the pressure away from him. He's the African champion, yes. This is the World Athletics Championship. Different competitors are going to be there. We know the Russians are very good at that. So he just said, we need to be calm. He's going to give his best in the World Athletics Championship.
Okay, let's now go to volleyball, and just to bring the viewers to speed on matters of volleyball. Malkia Strikers is in Tokyo, that is Japan, for the World Cup. And this comes even after there was some talk that they could focus on the All African Games to be held in Congo next month. But now it's clear. In fact, their opening match is against Cuba. So, John, what's your take to start with? Lungaho decides to focus on the World Cup, that is Japan, and not on Congo, Brazzaville, as many people had said. And even when the Malkia landed from that World Grand Prix in Australia, you know, they were saying, we'll go to Congo then. Why the change of mind?
Change of mind is because of the stage in which they're going to expose themselves. The World Volleyball Volleyball Championship is a big stage. African, the All African Games is just the same stage as the African Volleyball Championship that we saw them at Kasarani. They also went to Egypt. So it's an ordinary stage that they are used to it. This one is a bigger one, and I think it comes with bigger expectations. And I think Lungaho made the right choice to allow the Kenyan team to go and play in the World Athletics, with the World Volleyball Championship, because of the exposure they're going to get and the experience they'll get. It will be a better team when they come from the World Volleyball Championship compared to the same teams they're used to playing when it comes to the All African Games.
Of course, we've been talking about the volleyball in Japan, and for Malkia Strikers, we wish you the very best. May you bring those medals and that trophy back home. We keep on celebrating you. Now, let's go to football and start here in the country. The SportsPesa Premier League, or what many people have known as the Kenya Premier League. And you know, the Mashemeji Derby is taking place on Sunday. Now, Gor is soldiering on. It has that unbeaten record. Do you think Sunday will be the end of the road for Gor Mahia, or we are yet to see more rampage in terms of like the way they did to KCB 6-1 the other day?
No. Basically, what's going to happen on Sunday? It's a derby.
It's a derby.
On Wednesday, I attended a match between Gor Mahia and Nakuru All Stars.
Yeah.
And Drago Lugarushik was seated next to me. And I could see the disappointment in him. Why? Because he expected Gor Mahia to field the first 11. And then what did Coach Frank Natal do? He played four players from his first 11 team. That includes Bonfas Oluoch, Sibo Mana, Ziggy Mana, and Musa Mohamed. The rest were not regulars in the Gor Mahia team. So basically, he could not get the tactics that Gor Mahia will use on Friday. Gor Mahia need 9 points to win the Kenya Premier League title. If they go unbeaten, maybe they will finish with more than 80 points for the first time. I think in 2008, if I'm not wrong, that's the time Mathare United won the league with the record 63 points. So this time round, maybe we're going to see a better record. The difference between Gor Mahia and AFC Leopards is the same team, which is more improved with more exposure from the CECAFA and the CAF Championship, has stuck together with the same coach.
Okay.
AFC Leopards have changed a number of coaches. Okay, Drago Lugarushik is there. He consistently misses training. I think when I was attending that match on Wednesday, he had attended training on Tuesday. FC Leopards players had attended the training on Tuesday. They said maybe from there they're going to attend training regularly. Basically, FC Leopards side that will be facing Gor Mahia is a totally different side. The first 11 for FC Leopards at the moment, only three players were in the first team that played against Gor Mahia in the first leg, and they held Gor Mahia to a 1-1 draw. So this is the same side that's going to face FC Leopards with no changes, with more experience, more gelled, more dangerous, versus an FC Leopards side that has only three players from the team that faced them.
So what you are saying is that more likely Gor Mahia will soldier on and will not be shaken by the Leopards.
Everyone is saying the derby doesn't have respect for anyone. But I have to say this. There's no way Barcelona can be on fire and Espanyol comes and says anything can happen because it's a Catalan derby.
Yes.
There's no way you can say Borussia Dortmund can be on fire and say Schalke or four will come and say.
Yes. Well, we've been talking about the Kenya Premier League and some of the big matches expected this weekend. We have Gor Mahia and FC Leopards. That is Mashemeji Derby. Of course, whether it's Gor or AFC, that remains to be a matter of wait and see. But we cannot close this discussion without discussing the English Premier League. Now, John, let's not focus so much on the past. You know, I'm a Chelsea fan, and the past really doesn't go well with me. But let's look at some of the matches, you know, that are lined up. This Saturday, we have Manchester United versus Newcastle. Looking at it from both sides, the form that Manchester United is facing Newcastle, what should you expect?
Manchester United is playing boring football, I have to say that, because even after they beat Aston Villa, Man United in the English Premier League have made 3 shots on target, 2 goals, 6 points. That is a team that cannot attract a non-football fan to go and watch. It's boring football, that's what I'll call it.
You know, every time when you say of boring, boring football, that makes me believe you're an Arsenal fan.
No. I'll say that. Arsenal without trophies is always 60,000 in the stadium. Try that with Chelsea, no title, or any other team in the English Premier League. You'll see a difference. I'm just saying that. But Manchester United still lack that gel, still lack the style, because the standard Sir Alex Ferguson had set at Manchester United. This quick attacking football, counter-attack, last-minute goals, fighting, even if you're 3 goals down, you'll come and fight. So what basically is happening with Manchester United? The statistics that I've told you, 3 shots on target, 2 goals, 6 points. That's why Louis van Gaal, after the match between Manchester United and Brugge, he said, I wanted to kiss Memphis Depay, because he could not find a reason to kiss any other player. Kiss, I don't know what he means by that. But because Memphis Depay scored 2 goals when no one expected, the rest of the team did not play the kind of football that he wanted.
Well put. Now, let's go to Arsenal. You've really talked a lot about Manchester.
But I have to give you my prediction. United will win the match against Newcastle in a boring way.
In a boring way. Now, a big match. We have Arsenal playing Liverpool on Monday. Now, those are big teams. That is, you know, Liverpool is one of the top teams. Every time when you talk of football, you can't say that without mentioning Manchester United, Chelsea, Arsenal and Liverpool. So Arsenal versus Liverpool, your prediction as well?
4 players are going to decide that match. Arsenal are struggling. I don't know why. Because maybe they lost to West Ham. They are in a panic mode. I don't understand why. But we're not seeing the Arsenal that beat Chelsea, beat Everton and won a couple of pre-season matches. But I've always said Mesut Ozil, Arsene Wenger has always insisted on this. When he plays well, the team plays well.
Yeah.
When Coutinho plays well, Liverpool plays well. That is the difference. Who is going to decide that match? I'll say this. If Liverpool find a way of taming Mesut Ozil, because out of 56 passes that he's made in the English Premier League so far, in the 2 matches they've played, 54 passes are accurate passes. That means his passing rate is like 97%. That's Mesut Ozil. How do you stop him? You can't stop him. You just have to make sure you've tamed the likes of Kasante Kazola. Arsenal have options in their midfield compared to compared to Liverpool, because Liverpool, the guy who is driving that, the driving force is Coutinho. Once you tame Coutinho, Benteke will not get those balls to score. They don't have a Sterling. Firmino is trying to fit in the English Premier League. Yeah. Sanchez, we saw a little bit of Sanchez in the match against Crystal Palace. This is a big one. So basically, according to me, Mesut Ozil and Alexis Sanchez will decide this game for Arsenal if they have to win. Then for Liverpool, I'll say Coutinho and Benteke. But it's easy.
Now let's go to the predictions. That is Arsenal versus Liverpool on Monday.
I predict a 3-1 win for Arsenal.
3-1. You know, we'll be here next Saturday.
And no problem.
We'll review your predictions. So anyway, we'll talk more about that. And finally, let's talk about the transfers now. We saw a very unique scenario of Pedro. So many people had thought that he's going to Manchester United, but the latest that we have is that Pedro is going to Chelsea. And Chelsea, I just mentioned, will be playing West Brom on Sunday. And hopefully, maybe, anyway, we'll see how that match goes. But Pedro is on the move to Chelsea.
Pedro going to
what
Chelsea
do you read Sunday. From that? And is Pedro now the person that will bail out Chelsea, because they have not been doing very well?
The reason why Pedro was bought, I have to say this, Manchester United has been like a bids club. They bid others sign. Nathaniel Klein, Firmino, talk of Benteke. I mean, all those guys are going to Liverpool. Manchester United have made a bid. We were sure that Pedro is going to join Manchester United. But a difference, Ed Woodward was in Catalan to sign Pedro. What happened after that? Mourinho made a phone call and Pedro was at, changed his mind. Now, the difference Pedro is going to make at Chelsea is that he's going to score a couple of goals and create chances. He's not a selfish player. He's played in a big team.
But at the end of the day, what matters is the scores. That's really what you get points from, whether you score or not.
That's true. He was bought because those who are playing in his position are not scoring as many goals as Mourinho expects them to score. Oscar is not giving his best. The likes of Cuadrado. When Cuadrado was playing against Brazil in the World Cup, you could see the best of Cuadrado. Fiorentina, he was a star. Same thing to Mohamed Salah. He was brought in because Mohamed Salah had gone to Fiorentina on loan. And we saw how they performed there. So I think there's a problem with these Brazilians coming to the English Premier League and other and South Americans, basically, because we didn't see the best of Di Maria. We haven't seen the best of Cuadrado. Pedro has been brought in because he is the kind of a player who follows the instructions. And Mourinho likes robots. Go there, do this. Pass the ball to Costa. Costa will score the ball.
That's why he won last season.
That's how he won it.
Of course, I can't leave this conversation. Your predictions, West Brom versus Chelsea on Sunday?
Last time these two teams played I think the second last game in the English Premier League. And Mourinho, I remember one thing, he went to the crowd and said, number one. Even if you've beaten our 3-0, we are number one. And he said, blame Arsenal, blame Chelsea, blame Arsenal, blame Manchester United and Man City. Because they've made this league boring. We are winning it with a couple of matches to go. This time round, it's going to be different. We're going to see a better side for Chelsea. But if he sorts out his issues with John Terry, Abramovich listens to him big time. So he has to make sure he's made defenses with Chelsea. With the John Terry, we'll see a better Chelsea side. But I'm predicting Chelsea will win by at least maybe two goals to nothing.
To nothing.
Yeah. You know, talk about champions. Champions like Man City.
Man City, yes.
Man City is the team to beat this season. They have the
money. But I think it's too early to start talking about the winners. Right now, we can only talk about the matches that are being played because, you know, right now, even from the table, English Premier League, I think it's too early to...
Once you beat the champions, my friend, you are the favorites.
No, really.
Once you don't concede any goal and don't make mistakes in the first two matches of your season, all three, we give them advantage for doubt because they're playing Everton.
Is that you are going to be here.
They're playing Everton. City is the team to beat. Yeah. It's a complete team at the moment. If they get Kevin De Bruyne, believe me, that's firepower. But they have depth in each and every department.
Anyway, we've been speaking to John, our guest analyst, and this is where you'll find him every Saturday at 2 p.m. and 8 p.m., basically talking a lot in terms of what to expect in the English Premier League and also the Kenya Premier League. At this point, we call it a wrap. Let's do this next week.